Before we start, let's do a quick show of hands. How many of you are representing SaaS companies, work for them or have founded SaaS companies? Let's do a quick show of hands. A good chunk. How many of you here are investors, angels, investor with a private equity, venture capitalists? Far fewer number. And I take that it's the rest of the world, those who have not raised the hand so far. So, you know, yeah, today in the morning, I went to Yahoo Finance and I was doing some quick research. And I went to the name in SaaS, which is, I guess, the best known, Salesforce.com, and I was checking its market cap. And the market cap was $27 billion. And I was recounting, as Neelu just pointed out in my background, I worked for Siebel in the Bay Area, and that was in 2003, 2004. And in those days, we were very, very dismissive about the concept of software as a service. Salesforce.com had come around. We had heard its name, so it was, I guess I should say, big enough to be known, but not really there in terms of revenues at that point in time. We all were very dismissive, but at that point, Siebel thought that it might be worth launching its own solution, which was called Siebel On Demand. And I remember testing it in 2003. But I was very clear in my mind that this thing is never going to take off. There is no market for this thing. I think a couple of years later, Siebel got bought out by Oracle for $5.6 billion. And look at where Salesforce.com market cap is. Look at PeopleSoft. It was sold to Oracle for $10.3 billion. Was clearly the Rolls Royce in the HR space. They had a pretty broad portfolio beyond HR as well. Look at what the same set of founders have done with Workday. It's $12.7 billion market cap as of today morning. Right? Took years to build PeopleSoft to what it did. And today, with far fewer revenues, it has a market cap of $12.7 billion. So clearly something has changed in all these years. Many folks like me, who are pretty dismissive about the entire concept, I think are beginning to change their minds. So in the panel today, we'll explore some of the issues around building a SaaS company. What does it take to build it out of India? We have truly a AAA panel here today. So we have Aneesh, Abhay, Atul, as the name suggests. It's a AAA panel here with us today. All three of them represent some of the best known names of startups coming out of India. So we look forward to getting some insights from them. So let's actually begin a little bit questioning SaaS itself a little bit, if I may. And clearly, as my background suggests, I represent the dinosaurs of the industry, whereas the three of them represent the new age companies. But you know, as I meet with large CIOs, I still find a fairly healthy dose of skepticism around SaaS. I mean, some will talk about the fact that they're experimenting with it. Some will talk about some peripheral use of SaaS, but it's not yet mainstream. I still find those, if I may use, sort of old, junky, not easy to use kind of software from the legacy world still being out there. Whereas there are some people who will say that if it's not SaaS, we are not even going to look at it, right? So Aneesh, let's begin with you. As you go and approach customers, do you find that SaaS has truly arrived, or do you think there is some distance to go? Do you think there is going to be a coexistence with on-premise? Where do you see it going?
I think, you know, as you rightly pointed out, I think the world is changing. You know, so in our own experience, you know, companies in India also, like an example I can give is about 2-3 years ago, we pitched to Mahindra Retail to buy in our SaaS CRM for them, and they just wouldn't budge. You know, and this year they finally bought, and we're probably the first SaaS implementation that Mahindra has ever done. You know, so the world is surely changing, and it's and change happens over a period of time. You know, so I'm reasonably sure probably in 10 years from now, you know, SaaS will be larger than software. You know, but it's just a matter of time, and you know, even internationally, what we're seeing is the companies which are more, you know, sub-$1 billion seem to be very open to SaaS. You know, even if you look at Salesforce, their first 2, 3, 4 years were all about much smaller companies. And now as they've, I mean, once you have a critical adoption, I think all the large guys have also bought in like a CRM with them on, you know, on a SaaS platform. It's just a matter of time, really. Yeah.
Abhay, is there, I think the voice is gone. Abhay, is there something about relatively smaller companies, again, $1 billion, not necessarily small, but Aneesh referred to companies below $1 billion. Is there something about them why they prefer SaaS?
So So, because our major focus is always the India market. So, we have two kinds of clients. So, when you talk to a small retailers or small clients, I think there is a very little awareness among them about the SaaS and on-premise software. But particularly software itself, where to pay money for software is not really an accepted term for them even today. Even the enterprise side, Anish was talking about the big enterprise companies. We had some of them as a client. So 4 years back when we went to them and we asked them that this is our platform and which you have to use on a SaaS model, the reaction was completely different. And he gave an example of Mahindra, but I will not name the company, which is a billion-dollar retail company in a jewelry segment. So when I met a founder, the managing director of the company, he said, you have everything ready. Why are you charging us a monthly fees? It was in Hindi, almost like, tere paas to sab bana hua hai, toh paisa kyun charge kar raha hai? So I think we have seen those kinds of experience from the people. And even from a smaller segment, we saw a couple of customers signing up for a small $50 account on Martjack and calling us next day that I'm sending a person to collect a CD of a source code. So the understanding about the whole SaaS in this industry is growing, as Anish said, but still it is at an early stage where people are still understanding a difference between a SaaS and on-premise software.
Atul, you know, again, as I was recounting my first encounter with Salesforce.com, I think sales was probably one of the first areas where people saw the emergence of SaaS companies. Since then, a lot has happened. Are there any specific industries or functions where you think that SaaS is more meaningful vis-a-vis the others? Is any pattern to be drawn?
Sure. I think there's a number of patterns, and really it depends on what market you're talking about. I think the India market is very different than, you know, mature market like the US. For example, at Manthan, half our deals in the US are SaaS requests from the customer itself. So it's not us selling, you know, SaaS versus on-premise. In India, it's a completely different ball game, like we talked about. I think in terms of spaces, again, you know, contextual to the market in the US, obviously, you know, it's a very, very competitive market. So whatever could be SaaSified has been SaaSified. I think that trend is accelerating. In India, I think there's much more opportunity as you talk to enterprises. And we've, by the way, we have literally no customers in India. And I'll try and talk about why that's so. And we're hoping to change that. But I think the level of investment in infrastructure, things like analytics, if you look at the retailers, I think that's beginning to ramp up. And when retailers look at that, they want to sort of test the water. So I think SaaS is a perfect way to do that, sort of do a trial and, you know, easy entry, as well as there's lesser barrier to exit if things don't work out, right? So I think in terms of domains and markets, I think everything is open field as far as I see in India. In the US, it's very mature, depends on which domain. And I think there's been a lot of success in the last couple of years, companies exiting that started with a pure SaaS model. So if you look at that study, I think that will tell you where the opportunities are.
Okay. So Atul, let's actually stay with you. You know, the interesting thing about the three panelists is that Atul mentioned that he virtually has no customers in India. We had Abhay who said pretty much all his customers are in India. And I was talking to Aneesh earlier, I think he has a mix of his customer base in both India and outside India. And one of the things that always perplexes me is that if I go back to the days of services, you know, go back to when Infi started, TCS started, all those times, so far we have been talking about a lot of labor arbitrage related things. There was a clear advantage as to why you should build a services company out of India. Now people are beginning to challenge that too at the moment. Is there something fundamental, Atul, where you think a company coming out of India has an advantage in the SaaS world?
Sure. I think if you were to start a SaaS company from scratch, I would focus on building a product for the global market, perhaps focus it on India or emerging market, see where the opportunity is. But in terms of building the product, obviously, I mean, the price point can be lower in terms of your cost. The challenges are, you know, well known. Building any great product, you require a great team. And so I think the talent is here in India. If you're looking at, you know, more senior level, very experienced talent, you know, that becomes a pyramid. If you're looking at particular skills like user experience is a very important aspect of SaaS. So at Manthan, we've redone some of our products to a pure SaaS model, multi-tenant. So we put a lot of attention to the user experience, simplifying the use cases, you know, working with domain experts there. That's one area. The second obvious one is product management. Having I think that's really the key element of building a very, you know, a good product. And there, either you need very strong domain knowledge or you need someone who's, you know, built very successful commercial products. And those are two metrics I look at, you know, when we look to hire. And so I think those are two challenges. So besides cost, I think if you build a product out of India for the global market, let's say versus the US, I think you have a better opportunity to be a global player. Sitting here, you can understand Asia Pacific and, you know, obviously India. In the US, you may focus just on the US market. At some point, you know, it may be afterthought that let me expand internationally. So I think there's pros and cons and you can use it to your advantage.
So Aneesh, I actually want to continue that question with you, because Atul mentioned that, you know, like they're focusing on the global market, you're focusing both on global and Indian market. He talked about the importance of product management as well. He did say that there is certain cost advantage in the product development side. Two questions for you. Number one, does that cost advantage in product development really matter? Is that a significant part of your cost structure? Number one. Number two, the product management skills that Atul talked about, that domain expertise that he talked about, if you're serving customers outside India, do you think that those exist?
Right, so there is surely a big advantage in cost. You know, if you look at most of the good SaaS companies out there, they spend about roughly 35% of their, of their revenues on technology. And being an Indian company, you have a big advantage there. And the other advantage we really have, especially Bangalore for that matter, is you have very good talent in terms of people you can pull out of a Google or a Yahoo or a, you know, a lot of companies like that. So if you really ask me, we probably outside the US, probably Israel and Bangalore must be the two places where you can get good product managers. I'm not sure you will find them in as much number elsewhere. You know, so from a product standpoint, the only real problem you might face is, you know, distance from the market, you know, if you're trying to build a global market. But the way we've sorted that is we've sent early team members into those markets. You know, so the first sales guys for us used to be guys who are early, know the DNA of the company, can give feedback fairly quickly. You know, so that's how we bridge that gap. So there's surely a, and the other piece is, I don't know how many of you have read the Bessemer's 10 Laws of SaaS. It's a fairly good, I think it's a must read for any SaaS entrepreneur. And one of the laws actually says SaaS is more about service than about software. And that's very true, because if you really want to build a profitable SaaS company, churn is the most important thing you need to keep looking at. You know, you can't allow a very high churn rate. And that's where, again, you know, India comes up quite well. You know, you're essentially, when you're talking about churn, you're essentially talking about good account management, which you can probably still do on the phone from markets like India, as compared to, you know, face-to-face in markets like the US or elsewhere. So the first point, I do believe that there's a major, major advantage in terms of, you know, we haven't seen too many profitable SaaS companies in the US. I think we'll have profitable SaaS companies out of India, which serve the global market. You know, so that's my view.
So Aneesh, I'm going to pick up on the profitability theme later, but I want to come to Abhay. Abhay, you mentioned earlier when we were talking that you have largely built your company around customers in India initially, and now you have begun to experiment outside India. Did you find that when you were catering to the Indian market, you built a product for that market, are you having to rethink your product or offering itself as you are beginning to go outside India? Are you finding that the audience outside needs a very different kind of product offering itself, or is it largely the same thing that you're offering outside?
I think our experience is that 80% of the product which we built is completely ready to use for the global markets. So I can say that whatever works in India in terms of the product can be worked in any global market with little localization of 10 to 15 or 20%. But other than that, there is no big development or engineering effort really required to customize it for the global markets.
Just to add to that, so if you look at the Indian market, you know, so most of the large guys here would fit well into being the $50 million to $1 billion guy in the US. So their technology needs would be very similar. So unless you're going behind the absolute large guys in the market, a product which you have in India will 90-95% work well with markets outside. The issue that you have to address well is actually your delivery model, because India works on Jugaad and the West or the Chinese don't understand Jugaad. They just don't get it. I mean, or rather we need to change so that's the area that you will need to crack more to actually take your product out from India to a West kind of a, West or East, both ways.
So, Aneesh, I think it'll be useful. Expand on it. What kind of jugaad do you do here, which you think is actually not understood by people outside and why it's not relevant?
Right, so in terms of jugaad, like, you know, as any product company, you know, you would keep getting constant requests on build this feature for me, build that feature for me and stuff like that. And you know, the way we typically approach it in an Indian context is say, haan, 2 mahine mein ban jayega, but you deliver it in the third month. Actually, the right way to do it is to say, we'll take 6 months and deliver it in 5 months. You know, the same feature.
Interesting. Actually, Atul, I want to pick you up on that one because this is a classical conundrum. I mean, as I said, I belong to one of the dinosaurs in the industry, or I used to work for them. But, you know, our model was very much that we go in, large implementations, lots of customizations will happen. You'll implement the product for 1 year. You mentioned earlier that you are going to market with both the models. You're going with a SaaS model, you're going with the non-SaaS model, I guess the on-premise model. As you have begun to go into the SaaS model, are you finding that to be a challenge, which is that are people asking you to deviate from the standard? And if so, is that making the scalability of the model a challenge itself?
Sure. Yeah, they're really two different worlds. And at Manthan, we have two sort of categories of products. One is analytics, BI. The other is execution of analytics. So, you know, lately we've introduced products that get into, you know, promotion and offer engines, you know, based on dynamic triggers, customer attributes, and, you know, basket conditions, etc. So very dynamic product, multi-tenant SaaS hosted on Amazon. We've also created a mobile product, which is the last mile communication to the end user for a retailer, right? So when you take those products to SaaS, I think the challenge is to limit the degree of customization, because in SaaS, as I call it, you cannot afford to fork the product too much, you know, then you cannot scale. So our on-premise product, the BI product, has a fair amount of deployment and customization, which we live with. When we take that to the SaaS model and we put it on Amazon components, you know, we maintain that customization ability. The execution products are much more like Salesforce, where, you know, we try and strive for the retailer to adjust to the, you know, to the business process and the product. And, you know, we have enough APIs, interfaces, and adapters where, you know, we can sort of meet their custom needs. But beyond a point, you need to draw the line. And I think that's the tough part, especially as you're trying to really get adoption of the product. So I think that's where product management and even having your sales and, you know, sales engineers, you know, not overly overcommit for the product is very important.
Okay. Aneesh, I want to come back to your profitability comment. It's actually one of my favorite topics. And the reason it's one of my favorite topics is because, you know, you look at the gorillas of the on-premise world and look at the gorillas of the SaaS world. Most of the gorillas of the on-premise world, and granted they're much larger, but these guys operate somewhere between 30 to 40% operating margins, right? I was used to SAP, which I think was 31, 32% operating margin. Oracle was, I think, 40. Microsoft is somewhere in between as well, or at least that's what I recollect. Again, you look at the financials of Salesforce.com, and I'm picking on Salesforce.com just as an example because it's the largest. They closed on Jan 31st this year with $3 billion plus revenue last year. At $3 billion revenue, which is a pretty non-trivial revenue, they had an operating loss of $110 million. And that's the operating loss. I'm not counting other interest costs, everything else. And for a company which has pretty much defined the space with their scale, their market cap, they're still at an operating loss. And as you begin to drill into the financials, you realize that the cost on sales and marketing is just absolutely humongous. In fact, one of my colleagues in Helion had done some analysis that 50% is usually the average cost of sales and marketing for SaaS companies. They're actually even slightly higher. If at that scale, that's what they're, that's a challenge they're facing. So Aneesh, I want to challenge you a little bit. Let's combine two different facts here. Number one, that you are selling your product outside India as well, where I would imagine price points are higher. Number two, you believe that the profitable companies in SaaS will be in India. Now, especially when you will end up having, let's say, a market outside India, why would your sales costs be lower than the gorillas in this world? And why would you be able to build a profitable SaaS company?
Right. I think your cost of, if you look at Salesforce, if you want to continue growing at like a 30-35% year on year, the thing with SaaS is most of your cost actually comes in the first 3 or 4 months. When you're paying the sales guy out, when you're actually getting the client live, all that. And if you're growing at a 30-35% year on year, you're going to actually put all that cost of getting those clients up in your first year itself. So I think if you were to hit a moderate balance between, you know, your rate of growth and your, you might be able to turn profitable. The other piece is, even if you look at Salesforce, about 30% of their cost is on technology and technology salaries and things like that, you know, which is a major, major arbitrage you can have in India. You know, like, I believe that, you know, at a reasonably good stage, we should be having 15 to 20% as cost of technology for us, you know, which is a good 20% down from you know, the number there. So, you know, that's my, the other piece is, the other advantage with India is actually, you know, your churn would be far lower because you can give much better account management, you can do a lot more customization because you're based in a market like India as compared to, you know, a market like the US where both account management and customization are going to be massively expensive, you know. So, as a combination, I firmly believe, you know, that.
I think Atul is dying to comment. Go ahead.
Yeah, I just want to add to Aneesh. I completely agree with him. I think it's a misnomer that, you know, you cannot make a SaaS company profitable. I think it really depends on how quickly and how much you want to scale it. So I think the main investment in scaling the business goes in sales and marketing. In fact, Abhay and I were just talking about an article that talked about in the US, the last 10 SaaS, pure SaaS plays that went IPO had about 40 to 50% of spend on sales and marketing, 20% on R&D. So at some point, if you want to, you know, you say I've had enough scale, you can, you know, scale down on your sales and marketing and have healthy margins, right?
So Abhay, before you comment, I know you're dying to, I'm actually going to ask you a follow-up question on this topic. Aneesh referred to 35% continuous growth as, in a way, rapid growth, scaling. Not trying to pick on your percentage here, don't get me wrong. Do you think as a young entrepreneur, or entrepreneur of a young company rather, I should say, actually both, you're pretty young as well. Do you think you have a choice of making that call of moderate growth today? I mean, is lack of hyper growth even an option for someone new at your size and therefore not investing in that scaling? Okay, let me rephrase my question. I think what both Aneesh and Atul were referring to is that the reason you have very high sales and marketing costs is because you are investing upfront to be able to build that scale. Right? It is true. I mean, you typically look at Salesforce productivity, usually you have to hire a person 1 year. I mean, it takes a year to get a sales guy productive, normally. So for the growth that you need to do the following year, you're actually hiring, you're actually incurring your sales cost even the previous year. And which is why the P&L of most of these companies get completely wacky. The question is though, is that lack of growth even an option for someone at this stage? I mean, 3 billion is the largest we are talking. Most of the companies are probably going to be 10 million, 20 million, 50 million. At this stage, is there lack of growth an option? And therefore, how do you handle the sales and marketing cost?
Yeah, so this business definitely needs a huge investment on the sales and marketing. I think we do not have an option whether we should focus on the growth or profitability for first 6 to 7 years. We have been investing on sales, marketing, as well as technology also for last 6-7 years. And now we have started seeing some results after spending 5 years on enormous technology development and sales effort. So I think this business definitely needs a lot of investment. As Atul was also talking that of those 10 companies who have almost invested 45 to 50% of their budget into sales and marketing. But from Indian market point of view, I think our percentage is less. We are really not investing 45 to 50%. In the contrary, our more investment is going on the technology and product development. But at the same time, SaaS takes time. It's almost 6 years today. We are seeing some considerable number of revenue coming. Earlier, it was just an investment.
Just to correct it there, I don't think 35% growth is anywhere agreeable for a company which is less than 100 million in revenues. You know, at a 3 billion, it's a fairly large chunk. You know.
True. Let me move on to a slightly different topic. Atul, you are targeting sort of fairly high end of the pyramid in terms of the kind of companies you are targeting. And you said that you are selling outside India. For a company coming from India, and typically when you start, you don't have a brand behind you as well. You are going and selling to the big boys, and clearly, you know, I'm sure there'll be a salesperson from SAP, from Oracle, from Info, from many of these companies, IBMs of the world, sitting out there as well. How difficult is it to get your first couple of customers, and what does it take to make them referenceable?
So I think always difficult, right? There's no silver bullet or one answer there. I think either you have a product that really differentiates itself, technology that differentiates itself, or you have a business model or, you know, price point, or maybe all of the above. I think in the case of Manthan, just, you know, looking inward, I think we sort of had a first mover advantage. The company founded about 10 years back. Analytics was still, you know, in infancy in terms of mainstream retail, analytics for retail. So the company focused on those two pillars and made a name for itself, and it was, you know, incremental growth from there on. So today, I mean, US is our largest market. We've got some marquee retailers. And so referenceability helps. And so how do you get that first one? So number of things. I mean, if you're building a new SaaS company focusing on the US, for example, you know, definitely you need a great product. No doubt about that. You need to, you know, be very creative, free trial, freemium, you know, leverage social media, inside sales, you know, channel partners, marketplaces. I think all of the above, depending on what domain space you're in, I think it's always a challenge to get that first customer.
Got it. Abhay, one of the other choices that entrepreneurs have to make is whether to put feet on street, whether to go via channels. And in a SaaS kind of a model, in your opinion, what kind of a go-to-market makes sense? And what have you, I mean, what do you think has been successful for you?
So from the Indian market point of view, we tried almost all the options. Like we built an inside sales team, we had a field sales team. We tried to really partner with a couple of big companies like Google, where we thought we will get big numbers with them. We did a lot of shows where we had all these big clients with us. But practically speaking, from Indian market point of view, the only solution for the scale is a feet on street. Because it's a high touch sales, and particularly we are trying to cater the e-commerce market where the customization requirements are very high. People have big dreams about their, everybody goes to Amazon and comes back and say, I want Amazon. Amazon launched some new feature, they want immediately next day on their site. So there are more, because that is a front end which they're going to run their store there. So our issue that there, they need that person to talk, get more clarity. So feet on street from the scale perspective is required. Inside sales has definitely worked for us. After reaching certain stage, once we had world's largest retailer, India's largest retailer on our platform, then it was easy to sell from office also. Inside sales team used to sell it sitting in the office, because then we had some credibility in place that we have all these clients there. But the initial phase one, it is very difficult. We have to go in person, convince them and sell them. So from Indian market perspective, I see feet on street is the only solution to get us big scale.
Okay. Aneesh, on the same front of go to market, I mean, I've talked to a number of entrepreneurs in the recent month. One of the things that they all struggle with is whether to sell in India, whether to sell outside India. And the conventional wisdom that most people come up with is, again, whether they should go to emerging markets or should they go to US. And there are pros and cons, right? Price points may be very different in certain markets, but cost of sales is very different as well. And Abhay mentioned that you need to have your own feet on street. If we do believe that you are going to need feet on street, and that sales model is very expensive in certain countries vis-a-vis, let's say, India. There are lots of entrepreneurs here who are probably running young SaaS companies. What would your advice be to them? Would you be bootstrapping by selling in India, or would you advise that they should actually go to a more mature market?
I think that's a tough question. So just to give some context, the first, we're 5 years old as a company. You know, the first 3 years, we were only India-focused. India is a great market to actually, I believe there are a lot of early adopters in India. You know, people who are willing to buy at price points which are not great to talk about, but they at least help you build a great product very quickly. And so if you're looking at India as a ground where, you know, you want to build for the larger mass market in the world around, you know, when I'm saying the mass market, I'm not talking about a $1 billion-plus enterprise. I'm really talking about, you know, the 50 million to a billion kind of a guy who fits very well with the larger enterprises that India has. You know, so India is a great market to actually get your first 10, 15 customers, customize with them, build scale and stuff like that. But can you build a $100 million software or SaaS company out of India? I really don't think so. You know, and my friends here will never be interested in a company which is not going to be, you know, more than $100 million in revenue. So
by the way, that's not true. I'm interested in him. He's not talking to me right now.
Right. So I think, you know, as a product company from India, we have a great chance on building, you know, products for the world over, you know, whether it's from the East or the West. We actually took a route of saying, so US was the last market that we opened. You know, we just opened US about 8 months ago. Before that, we opened 8 other countries, you know, so I think that works well. You know, Singapore is a good cross in between India and the US. You know, so that's a market that you should hit next. Try out things like inside sales. The other good thing about India is most Indian customers love giving references. You know, so when we actually expanded from our first international clients, the guys in the UK, the guys in Singapore, Hong Kong, you know, some of them in the Middle East, were all through references that we got in India. We would work with Pizza Hut in India. They took us to Pizza Hut Singapore, Hong Kong, Thailand, Middle East, Egypt, you know, name it, you know, and Puma, again, the India guys took us across. Our UK customer was also through that. So I think the right thing to do is build a product in India. You have a lot of MNCs in India now. Go target them, you know, through them, reference out, you know, so then you don't really have the issue of who is going to be my first reference in a market like the UK, you know, so yeah.
So Atul, I want to actually ask you the same question. Aneesh mentioned that there are a lot of early adopters in India. Why did you decide to go to non-Indian markets, and what was your experience, sure, if at all you tried India?
Yeah, let me clarify. You know, we all love India. It's not that we didn't target India. I think we saw a much bigger opportunity globally. So US, you know, was the biggest source of demand for retail analytics, and we capitalized on that. Southeast Asia, for example, Philippines, I think we have 90% of market share in Philippines. There's a couple of large retailers. They just happen to be Manthan customers. So we actively look at India. It's just that in India, for the target segment, that the Manthan product makes sense, you know, and that is the equivalent in the US of $1 billion to $10 billion retailer. I think they're still building out the infrastructure, the ERP, you know, POS systems and all. But I think now they're warming up. They see a clear advantage to quickly getting on board the analytics bandwagon, and we're pursuing those conversations. And we've had some work done out of India, but nothing significant, and that's why I don't call it out. But, you know, my philosophy is, you know, go after the opportunity, focus on the use case, prioritize the use case, and you can localize it initially to get that reference. And in addition to prioritizing the use case, prioritize the use cases you don't want to do, you know, which is equally important. I think that's where, as a early SaaS startup, you know, you can meander and go in the wrong direction. I mean, classical, look at Apple, right? How many products do they have? I'm sure they had a ton of ideas for new products. So hold fort, you know, and it's a long-term play, especially in SaaS, but I think it's a very fruitful one long-term, you know, once you have a set of loyal customers, recurring revenue, and all of that.
Great, thank you so much. Thank you so much. And thank you to the panelists as well.